fortunate to have Professor Narendra Pani on at the PAC campus, and he's here to talk about his study on inequality that they're doing at the National Institute of Advanced Studies. So firstly, it's a real privilege, and we had a fantastic time at the talk that you had today. Your specific study on inequality, what social challenges, you know, does it address?
It recognizes, I think, primarily that inequality covers multiple dimensions, and we must try and first of all conceptualize it in a way that captures that, and then try and see it in the context of India and what are the processes generating inequality and what are its consequences. So study focuses primarily on the transition out of agriculture and the inequalities that generate, as well as the consequences primarily in terms of suicides, mainly farmer suicides.
Okay. A very technical question, actually. How do you relate economic determinism to inequality?
Well, it's really not. It's a fact that when you have economic determinism, you tend to focus on the economic dimensions of inequality or economic inequality as opposed to other inequalities. Okay. You tend to assume that other inequalities emerge from economic inequalities, as a result of which you tend to underestimate the resilience of other inequalities.
Okay.
Right? You can have situations like extreme gender inequality. It's assumed somehow that if you get economic growth, your gender inequality will decrease, which doesn't always happen. You find greater growth leading to situations like honor killings and issues like that. So I think there's a need for a definition or a perception of inequality that transcends these disciplinary boundaries.
Now, the last question, actually, we sent you 3-4 questions, but what do you think is the complex relationship that exists currently between migration, agriculture, and inequality, and inextricably linked, right? So how, you know, if you stress on one particular thing, there is a ripple effect on the other one. So how can India grapple with this particular thing?
I think the main thing is not to see it as a sectoral problem, but to see it as a problem in terms of you would treat it largely like a doctor treats a patient. There are multiple elements to it, they're all interconnected, but you find a point of intervention that you can change the way things are going, and you use that. Right. So you have to identify the processes, not ignore them, certainly not identify or break it up into separate sections.
Okay.
But look, like just as if I have a pain in one part of the body, you cannot say I will do something there irrespective of what that drug does to other parts of your body.
Okay.
Similarly, in this kind of situation, you try to address that by finding out the best point of intervention and taking it.
Okay. In such complex situations that the country is currently facing, what do you think, you know, civil society organizations and research organizations like NIAS and PAC, you know, where do we fit in? What is the role that, you know, such institutions can actually play towards a possible policy change for the better?
No, I think a major part of policy change or the absence of it comes from two kind of deficits. One is a deficit in there's a general feeling as if there's no, that we know everything that is to be known. Right. There isn't enough recognition that you need, that there might be some basic problems that we don't fully understand. So there is a need for research within that. And the second is that this research itself is a specialized activity. And I think there is a certain value in ensuring that research goes with a certain academic rigor and then links up with activists. The idea of researchers becoming activists and activists becoming researchers has gained a lot of following over the last, I think, 2-3 decades. But I'm not sure it works.
Okay. So in this particular scenario, where are the areas that you think that NIAS and PAC can work together? In terms of migration, I'm sure the director has talked about our current, our project. So where are the areas that, you know, that the collaboration can actually happen?
I think that would require a greater, a more detailed analysis of what each other. But certainly we are looking at parts of migration, but with the larger question of the impact on inequality and how inequality in turn affects migration.
Okay.
Trying to understand the dynamic. And I'm sure that there's scope for more than one institution to do it. But the precise areas would require a greater scrutiny of each other's area. I'm not even sure what exactly PSC is doing, so I can't point to it. But I'm sure there'll be areas where we can complement each other.
Okay. And finally, during your talk, you said that even during academic and research rigor, there is an element that you need to understand that, let not the let not the best be the enemy of the good, right? So, during your research, when you all do, where is that cutoff that you say that we're going ahead with this, and despite the fact that there may be a lot of ramifications or critique from otherwise?
That's okay. The idea is that you try to be the best. But if for some reason you cannot be, there's not enough data or something else, we don't stop and say, therefore we do nothing. That's all there is to it. Even if you cannot be the best because there's a lack of data or any other constraint, we try and do as much as we can so you get a sense of this is a good approach.
Thank you so much, sir.
Okay, my pleasure. Thank you.